is a pagan, and yet she has helped the king. I am to trust a stranger with my child.
There is good in Isolde.
From Providence, Rhode Island, welcome to The Last Kingdom with Mary and Blake. It's a podcast dedicated to The Last Kingdom on Netflix. So let's see how England was born. My name is Mary Larson.
My name is Blake, and oh boy, do I remember those long sleepless nights with sick babies.
Ooh-wee. I mean, even sick kids. I mean, our kids right now are 6 and 8.
Yes.
And one of them had tummy troubles just this week, and yeah. I was up all night. Yeah.
Actually, yeah. All four of us were in our bed together.
True. Yeah. It never ends, does
it? No,
it
never
ends. Someone
ever
once told me that you will sleep again soundly when your youngest is 7. I'm here to say I doubt that's gonna.
I'm here to say they lied.
We do sleep more consistently though, right? We do. So,
yeah. I would say that. Yes.
There is something to that.
but still.
Oh my goodness gracious! Well, hello everyone, and welcome, of course, back to The Last Kingdom. We are so excited we're here, of course, in the penultimate episode. Before we delve into it, though, we wanted to remind you that this podcast is brought to you by our friends at jointhenerdclan.com. If you enjoy this, if you enjoy any of our podcasts, head on over to jointhenerdclan.com for as little as $2 a month. That's less than a cup of coffee, less than a cup of Joe. You could support this mom and pop podcast endeavor. This is honestly my full-time job. This is Blake's part-time job, making sure that we can keep all these podcasts and media company going. So thank you to our friends who already support us. And if you'd like to jump on in, the water is just fine. There's extra perks and wonderful things there. You can find us on all sorts of social media. Just search Mary and Blake. We've got an exclusive Facebook group. Check that out too. Mary and Blake, you'll find that super easy. All right, let's get into the show.
Well, this was episode 7 of The Last Kingdom. As Mary said, it is the penultimate episode of season 1,
yes.
As there are only 8 episodes in this season, which is crazy. Like, I didn't.
But these episodes are so full. These
they
episodes make you feel like you've watched 2 or 3 episodes. There are multiple moments in each one where I'm like, oh, wow, it's done. Nope, it's not.
it's going.
Okay, let's
like,
do
it's,
this.
It's a full hour.
Oh, yeah.
It is a bit. Like, you know, there are some shows that are like, you know, like 49, 52 minutes-ish.
Yeah.
Oh, no. This is a full hour.
And you feel it.
Yes.
You definitely feel it. All right. So absolutely. Tell me a little bit about this episode.
All right. It was directed by Peter Hoare.
Right.
Now, this person
terrible
is actually,
last name.
It is not a great name.
Poor
I mean,
thing.
There's just,
I mean,
not great, Bob.
However, you absolutely, Mary, know Peter Hoare's work.
Okay.
He has directed many episodes of The Umbrella Academy,
love
which is a personal, extraordinarily personal favorite of Mary and
Monkeys
Blake.
In Space.
Monkeys in Space, man. That's what
That's
it comes down to.
That's just the cover image on Netflix.
he actually directed The White okay, Violin, Monkeys. which was the season finale of season 1.
Okay, yeah. Oh,
so,
yeah.
So, yeah, that was, yeah.
If you guys want a bananas show, pun intended.
There's a whole bunch of other shows here. Cloak
Monkey,
and Dagger,
bananas.
Altered Carbon on Netflix, The Runaways, The Defenders, Iron Fist, Daredevil. So he was really big in like
in
Marvel.
In like action kind of things.
Yeah.
Okay.
And
which I can see for a lot of this episode, yeah.
He's also directed episodes of Da Vinci's Demons and Shetland
okay.
as well as Doctor Who, too. Hmm. The writer was, once again, Chris Bouchard, the showrunner of The Last Kingdom for seasons 1 through 3. Marvin,
yes,
your Shields rating.
This is my highest one. It's a 4.9.
All right.
Yeah, we've got there. We're here.
Right.
We have arrived. It's taken me a while. And it's not that I don't like this show. It's just not necessarily one I would have picked out.
Yes.
But I'm here. I'm here for it.
She's ready to go. And we are finally getting back to Mary and Blake media norms, where your rating is higher than mine.
Yes.
That feels much better. I feel like we're in a comfort zone now.
Kilter,
I was just like, it was way too much for me to have you to have me higher than you.
That's okay.
I don't like it. I don't like when that happens.
All right. Before we get into the GBGs.
Well, I didn't give you my rating.
What is it?
It's a 4.8.
It's lower than mine. Oh my God. That still is super high.
Yes, it is. It's very high. Very high.
Yes. I dig it. Well, before we get into the GBGs, the good, the bad, and the great of the episode, we do want to remind you that this episode is brought to you by Minute with Mary. It's in addition to podcasting, I love to play with makeup and help people feel more confident and creative. And I actually have a brand new product on sale this month of August. And it's magnetic lashes.
Oh, hey, girl.
Because I love lashes. I love mascara. I love getting my lashes nice and stronger and healthier. And now I have like simple, easy to use lashes. So you can get magnetic lashes or my magnetic liner and lashes at a 15% off discount. All you need to do is go to minutewithmary.com/discount to grab yours. All right. GBGs, Blake, our goods, our bads, and our greats.
What do you got?
My good for this episode was the fact that the king burnt bread.
You know what? That's a great good.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's a great good.
Yeah, right?
Because such a small little detail. He's like,
and Isolde's just like, I asked you to do one thing.
You had one job to do, dude.
That's it. And he's like, oh, yeah. I guess I'm never going to try to cook again. Whoops.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
Like, you know, that's like the old adage, like, if you never want to go food shopping ever again, just buy all the wrong stuff.
Yeah.
And your partner will never send you again.
Pretty much. He just took the lazy person's way out of everything. Oh, my gosh. My bad was, it's not anything bad that the show did, nor that the actors did. It's just how terribly I felt for the queen, who I really don't like. And I really don't like her, like, faux beard look that she's got going on half the time.
It's very How to Train Your Dragon 3, you know, rough
like,
nut.
Like, what are we doing here? Nut? Get a scarf.
Just cry into my full, thick beard.
Exactly. It's like she forgot her tweezers to pick her chin hairs, and she's just like, oh, this will do. I'm the queen. I can totally start a new fashion. It's fine. But you just felt so bad for her.
Yes.
You know, I feel like parents nowadays and for all time, this goes to show you medical choices that you make for your child's life.
Yep.
Choices that you make for your child's life in general, you know, choosing the right school. You know, here we are. I'm not even trying to get into it. Okay. I'm not getting into this. So friends and comments, it's not supposed to be. But a discussion right now is going to be to vax or not to vax your kid.
Or to
mask
or to not mask.
Yes. Like, there's just all these different things where, like, people have their own personal opinions and they feel so strongly about it. And I'm just watching this, feeling the angst as a mother myself about medical questions that you've had, life or death things that you may have. So that was just my bad, is I felt those tears. And I gotta say, the actress, her runny nose.
Oh, her runny nose game?
On point.
Woof.
I love when people cry and they've got runny noses, because I know when I cry, I got all the runny boogies. Yeah. Okay?
The runny boogies.
It is not a pretty cry. And it's like, my eyes say, we know that this would look cute if you were crying, but let's give you boogers. Let's really, really work the waterworks.
What was that word again?
The boogers.
Your cousin from Boston.
You're welcome.
And then my great is that nobody died in the fights. Lyrfrich and Uhtred.
Yes.
Nobody died.
It was all just...
I know that that's a simple great.
No, but that's good.
But I dig their chemistry of their bromance.
Yes.
And I'm here for it.
The chemistry shared between those two is
particularly in this episode.
Excellent. All right. My good for me is actually Isolde. And not that I am in huge love with how Isolde was introduced in the show. I still think that her introduction was rushed, and it was forced almost. But I do love what her character brings in this episode.
Mm-hmm.
It brings tension. It brings a lot of great tension between what it is to be a Dane, what it is to be a pagan, and what it is to be a Saxon and being Catholic. But it's not on the nose, and it's not. Like, it's not repeating the same stuff that has happened earlier in this season.
Mm-hmm.
It's different. And it's different in a real tactile way, which makes the reality of the situation that much more viable. Like, we talked about that, actually. We were watching Loki, and Mary was saying, you know, I feel like I'm watching Tom Hiddleston.
In a theater.
In a theater.
Yes.
And... She's not buying into the reality. And I think that's because the emotional math for you doesn't add up. That's what it feels like to me.
And I think it's because Loki's dressed like he's in the 70s in a suit.
That's true. That's a good point. But I feel like it is a real tactile, thematic mode of persuasion that Iseult is in this, okay, and what she brings. And I really like that. My bad is that hard cut to the priest that's walking and it starts the music. It's like, duh, dun, duh. Remember when the priests went out to go
marshland, regular, like Wessex? Where are we? Give me a little bit
when
more
they were to leaving to let everybody know after the marshland that the king was alive, and they showed all the priests walking, and then you were like, Mary was singing to it. She's like, badass priest, badass priest.
Oh yeah,
yeah, I remember. It's so, like, they showed
the music just didn't fit.
It did not fit. It did not fit whatsoever.
No.
And it was a hard cut too. Like, yes, it was like, okay, Alfred holding the baby.
Yeah, and it was, and like, rock. It was like, yeah, they're going to win. The baby's alive. The priests are here to save the day.
Yeah, it was so weird. It was so weird.
Yeah.
And it was just this one shot of a priest walking up a hill or whatever it was.
Yeah.
And that was it.
Like, as if he was Goliath.
Yeah. Like, you would have thought that was Uhtred about to,
yes,
go light the ships on,
yes,
fire.
Yes.
And,
no,
and
it's,
no,
Bob.
It's Bob.
Not even Bjorka or,
no,
whatever.
It's,
no,
like, it's like
Bob.
Father Bob is, yeah, just walking along.
Father Bob's like, I'm so glad I made it.
He's like, where's some water? Oh, my God. Mm-hmm. Does anybody have a fig Newton?
I heard they were baking bread.
Yeah. My great, of course, is the position that this episode puts Alfred in as it relates to his faith. And I'm not saying that Alfred is questioning his faith, because I don't think Alfred ever would,
mm-hmm,
but it does open up some avenues for him where maybe what I believe isn't the 100% truth. Maybe I'm allowed to just take the advice of pagans here. And because there's a
even Uhtred at the end, he's like, God works a mysterious way.
Right. And he's like, didn't God create the pagans too? Like, there, mm-hmm, there's this whole thing. And you can see that there, it may not be a furious, raging battle.
No,
but
it's not
it is,
all black and white.
Right. It's not black and white. And that is where this show lives. And that is why I really like how they did, mm-hmm, this for this episode.
Just because you're king and just because you've read it doesn't necessarily mean that there's not other truths out there.
Absolutely.
That can work in tandem.
Absolutely. So that is my great,
cool,
being in the gray. And being in the gray is where this show should live. And when it does live there,
Gandalf,
it is. Oh my goodness. You are just such a nerd.
Gandalf the gray.
Nerd!
I'm actually playing not the Lord of the Rings score from the movies, uh-huh, but there were actually these wind ensemble pieces that were written for Lord of the Rings,
mm-hmm,
and I'm going to be playing them this year.
Oh my God, that is
a
double.
Nerd! There's one song all about Gandalf's horse.
No, you know what?
Nerd!
That's a triple nerd.
And you are going to come to that concert. Maybe I'll get you a t-shirt.
Oh, man. All right. What say you, Marvin? What is the thing that stands out to you?
Well, can we go a little chronologically? I think that that's going to help me digest,
yeah,
this,
sure,
episode,
let's,
a wee bit.
Go.
So we
let's
start
go.
Things off, of course, with the battle of battles, and then in comes Brita. And I was like,
oh, that reveal was that should have been a tie for me. That reveal of Brita was awesome, because we already know
that's
the
when the rock star music should have come in, not for the priests,
absolutely,
for Brita.
Brita should have had the rock star music.
Seriously. Oh my
so
gosh.
So good.
She comes in, she's got her red braids in. And I honestly thought, like, look at her. She's having the Danes come and save. Like, oh, the Danes must have found out that there's going to be this great battle between, you know, Uhtred, what is he?
Uhtred the Godless.
Uhtred the Godless. And then Leofric, and the Danes are going to come on in. And I just thought, like, his brother Dane, the guy with the R name, he was going to young Ragnar.
Yes.
Yeah. Young Ragnar was going to come and be like, don't touch my brother.
Yeah.
Like, I was ready for all that to go down. Not at all what it meant.
No.
Like, it just, he was just lucky. Like, that was the same day they picked to go invade Wessex.
Yes.
I don't think Brita even knew that that battle was, the way that they shot it, because we watched it a couple times, the,
yeah,
way they shot it, like, I don't even know if she really saw Uhtred. I felt like she just kind of, like, came into town. At first, because I thought Brita's here to save him, it was, okay, they're about to battle. This is the time we save Uhtred. But the second time I watched it, I don't even know if she knew she was
I don't think
there.
She saw him, yeah. The way that it was shot,
yeah.
at least.
It just more was like, oh, the dumb Wessex people are distracted by something.
Yes.
Let me go tell everybody it's a good moment to come
that's,
on in.
That's the way it felt to yes. me as well. She may have learned that there was a battle between Uhtred and Leah Fritsch, or maybe she just learned that there was a battle happening, like there was a one-on-one happening.
Yeah.
And they used that, like, maybe they heard it through the grapevine, and I know you want to do it. I know you want to do it.
Through the grapevine.
I saw it in your eyes. Maybe she heard it through you know all the people, and then mm-hmm. that's how they planned it. How do you feel about this whole thing, though? Like, is it? Do you buy it? Do you buy
yeah.
it? That's the way that it would go down?
Yeah.
And, really?
Oh yeah. You know, we've been playing a lot of chess here in this house over
yes,
the
we
summer.
Have.
Our kids now know it. Yes, they're 6 and 8. They're not perfect. Those nights are the tricky ones.
They are tricky,
the
man.
The L-shaped moves they got to do. But to me, this was, let's just continue this offensive line that we've got. You
yeah,
know?
Sure.
Like, let's go all in.
Yep.
We've got young Ragnar. He's getting ready to do his thing. But Guthrum, I think Guthrum, now that Ubba's dead,
yeah.
is kind of like, oh.
I'm the man.
Oh, and I'm actually good at this.
Right.
You know, like, I never thought I was good at it because all the sun shined on Ubba, but, like, I'm actually good at this.
Yeah, yeah. I just want to say...
I want to flex.
I am in on Guthrum's flex. Guthrum's flex is one... He comes from the clouds. Sorry, he comes from the forest. And just flexes all over the Saxons. And I just thought... He, as a character, is really good. He's really good because there are a couple of things that happen. He dismisses all of these people just off the cuff, just like, yeah, whatever, you know,
yeah.
and he's killing all these Saxons, and it's great. But he saves a couple. He saves one of them and says, you know, Guthrum is your god now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, go in peace and all that other stuff. And he just totally pantses Ethelwald. I mean, he pantses him to the center of the planet.
Yes, Ethelwald coming out, and I'm the real king.
Yeah.
And
get out
know.
Of here.
I mean, let's be real. This kid's still alive. We may not like him, we may not like his
right.
ways, but he is still alive.
And I'll give him credit, at least, for trying. Like,
yeah.
give him a little effort point,
yeah.
you know, like one point.
You're still here.
And you're trying, and you're trying to be the thing. And I watched him put the crown. I'm like,
he's in chess. He's just that little sneaky pawn that keeps going forward.
Yeah, like he's. Just
I may
waiting.
Be able to get a crown at the end.
But yeah, Guthrum's flex is one for the ages here, and the fact that the guy just comes in and sweeps Wessex. I mean, the strongest kingdom in England,
mm-hmm.
and just, yep, okay, it's mine. See you later.
Mm-hmm.
And uses. Not only his strength, but he recognizes the power of the written word as well. When he's in,
yes,
that is so. He calls it magic. He's
yes.
like, "This is magic without sound. This is mm-hmm. what I need." And it's funny because Ragnar and Breida are very quick to dismiss it. What did you think of Guthrum's?
I love
there?
It because I mean, you think back to episode 1 where Father Bjorka was telling young Uhtred,
yeah.
"You need to learn how to read. This is important." So, you know, here we are. Many people have already watched this series multiple times, so we don't know that much. But to me, this is reminding us as viewers that people who can read and the written word is going to play a massive role in this. It's not just that it's Alfred's special little magic, but for the Danes, someone's going to have to be able to read for them.
Yep. Yep, absolutely. And, there, you know, and of course, as we're talking about the invasion here, we should also be talking, too, I think, about the fight between Uhtred and Leah Fritsch. It really felt like they were going at each other. And the way that this was directed, you can tell that someone is very experienced with action, the way that Peter Hoare is,
mm-hmm.
because the way that this action was shot and the fight was shot was
yeah.
visceral. You were okay. right in it. And the camera... And there was another thing that I really liked, too, is when the Saxons invaded everybody, and they had this one shot that's following the horses into town,
mm-hmm.
and you're seeing all the people just get slaughtered, and it's like horses, or like it's like quick shots. It's they don't stay on it too long because it's just moving too quickly, and it's like you're a soldier that's in
okay.
the middle of it too. But the fight itself was expertly shot, and there's this one shot that I thought I really loved, which was Leah Fritsch and Uhtred are going in between hallways, and they come along the pikes, and all the pikes fall, and he grabs one, he throws it. Leah Fritsch throws it as Uhtred, like, at his head, and he just gets out of the way in a minute, Uhtred does. Really excellently directed. What did you think about the fight, and did you believe that these two were really going at
it? No, I totally did, and then what was interesting is it led right into the Dane invasion. And Leah Fritsch and Uhtred still had to continue. You think about, you know, even watching the Olympics, they're live being shown right now, and there was this one event in the triathlon where a boat got in the way. So, you know, a quarter of the men's triathlon athletes couldn't actually start their swim. And the rest of everybody's going, and they're swimming, and they're kicking, they're trying to get an early lead so they can have this early success. And they actually had to stop them and have everybody restart. They give them, like, 5 minutes to, like, breathe and get ready and then start again. And I was thinking about how the gentleman who started the race, giving it their all, swimming with their heart out, who then had to redo that. How, I wonder if any of them actually made it to, you know, even the top 10, even the top 20, because they gave their all. And that's what I was thinking with Leah Fritsch and Uhtred here. You know, they gave their all to stay alive in this fight. And then they had to go and, like, kill Danes and find their way to safety. So they go up and they find their way to safety. And that next scene that I really thought was interesting is when the nun was being attacked, and how it was a woman who chose to seek her.
Yeah, Isolde is no joke. Isolde is, oh, I'm really liking her character, and the problem that I have with her is that I know she's gonna die. I know it deep down in my bones, and it is unfortunate because I really like her. That woman stands up and says, nah, we're not doing this anymore. This is not gonna happen, and saves this nun. And doesn't care what Leah Fritsch says, doesn't care what Uhtred says, just does what she's going to do.
Yeah.
And that is it. You know, that is really important for her as a character. And it makes her, our little lass is joining
us. Such is life, right?
It happens. It happens. It's okay. And so Isolde is great. And I love what happens with her as a character, how she saves the nun. But also, like I said, does show up. And out of nowhere, when the king is, you know, in the marshlands and everything, just steps up and makes this tonic for him and says, yeah, okay, here you go. Just drink this and you'll be fine. Just out of nowhere. Just does it with unprovoked. Just shows up and takes care of it.
Yeah, no, I agree with everything you're saying. You know, she's giving her all. She's trying just to do the right thing and keep people alive and... I don't think she's long for this world either, sadly.
I think there's a great juxtaposition here between what happens with the fight. Because remember, they were saying that the reason why that there's this one-off battle between Leah Fritsch and Uhtred is that, you know, obviously they had to punish Uhtred and it was going to be a fight to the death. And that God would choose the survivor. But at the end of this episode, we have Alfred choosing to go to the word of a pagan to save his baby. So I love how there is a mirror here where God is supposedly he will choose the pure of heart, the one who is supposed to win, yet it has no power necessarily to save young Edward, the boy prince, the baby prince rather. No matter how many prayers there were, no matter how much Father Bianca says, oh, yay, great, all the prayers we've done, everybody, oh, that, like, a whole church.
That was us, right?
Yeah. That.
You're welcome.
Yeah, that was us. Yeah, oh, yeah. Yeah, that was us, right? Yeah, yeah, okay. There is this great mirroring here where the church really has no role, at least the way that it's shown in Edward's recovery. It is a pagan who has done this. So a great way to represent the battle in between what it means to be a Dane, what it means to be a Saxon, and how these two, especially through the form of Uhtred, are going to interact through the remainder of how their time together. You know what I mean?
Yeah, no. I feel like you've just been able to see their relationship, like, pull apart more and more and more and more. And yet, Uhtred is getting closer to Alfred and getting his trust more and more each day,
because, you know, When he shows up,
oh my gosh, when he's like, hey, priest, I hope you got a lot of money or something because we just saved your butt.
Yeah, right.
And then it turns out to be the king after all. That reveal was awesome.
Yeah, I was just going to ask about that. Like, what did you think about that? That was it just like, do you think that was just a little...
No, I loved it.
You thought that was good?
I loved it because to me it was like... You know, you've had those very few moments in your life where you're like, wow, that just worked out.
Yeah, right.
You know? That's what that was.
And one other thing that I really loved too in that scene was Uhtred is on the boat with everybody and he's pushing off and he's like 5 feet away from the land, right? Mm-hmm. And the Vikings are coming. The Danes are coming and they're on horses. And Uhtred's like 5 feet. There's nothing that the Danes can do except just like throw their swords, even if they could.
Yeah.
Like, they're 5 feet away, and you can't do anything about it. That was an interesting dichotomy right there.
Agreed.
Too. I thought that was
you know,
really
and
cool.
then where they're going, and the other Danes come on in, and Uhtred says, ultimately, Alfred. Oh, too many names.
Too many A's.
Who are these people? He says, you know, to really win, you need to make it one great battle. And if we kind of draw these people out from their ships, get them lost in the swamplands, bada bing, bada boom, let's do it. I loved that fight.
The swamp fight. Yeah. And you got to give it to Uhtred and to Leofric and to all these people who were just like, okay, we're going to wait for 30 Danes just to come running after us and be like 10 feet away from us. Mm-hmm. And then we're just going to run.
Yeah.
We're just going to run. We'll see what
it.
Happens. And what a great plan. What a smart plan. And I love that both Uhtred and Alfred recognize that they have to get one big battle. Mm-hmm. They have to get one decisive battle to put an end to all of the stuff that's been going on between the Danes, or at least, you know, to their ability of what they know. And that Uhtred not only saves Edward, the baby prince, but he comes up with this plan to defeat the Danes. He's producing for Alfred.
Seriously?
And it really does. Because my sense is that Uhtred will always be a Dane.
At heart.
I think there is a big part of him that is a Saxon, but there is a bigger part of him, to my understanding, that he's really a Dane.
Yeah.
And his love of Isolde is believable to me. Mm-hmm. I think the way that he reacts to situations is believable.
See, I don't see it as love. I see it as awe. Like, this is something that I've never seen before in a person. This is something that I admire. You know, he hasn't really... Like, he admired Breeda. I felt his love for Breeda, but that's because of the history that they had.
I don't know. If Isolde looked at you the way that she looked at Uhtred, whoo! You telling me you wouldn't question things?
No, but that's like lust. You know what I mean?
Yeah, sure.
And yeah, you can admire people, but I don't know. We need to like air her dirty laundry a little bit. She can't.
What do you mean?
She can't be this perfect. She can't just bippity boppity boo everyone to be better. And you know, just she can't be the perfect girl. That's all I'm saying. She's gonna have some skeletons in her closet.
I like the fact also that they didn't necessarily show the ritual. Because that ritual, like they showed how it was going to be practiced, she made the rune what looks to be in the mud, and that she shows Uhtred how the baby's going to be passed from one area to the place of hell through the mud and everything.
Ew, was it hell? I didn't see that.
No, from one area.
Okay.
Of the mud and to the other, like
yeah,
from
why
one.
Did you say hell?
No, I didn't say hell.
I thought you did.
No.
I thought you said move from one area of hell.
No.
Wow.
How to tell when the hosts aren't listening.
Well, that's my destined to be theory of the week, so I'm going to...
I think it's Uhtred's kid.
Oh, you beat me to it.
Mock me.
Oh, no, that's the wrong one. Wait. There we go. It's Uhtred's kid. Uhtred's kid totally dies.
Uhtred, son of Uhtred.
Yeah, Uhtred, son of Uhtred.
Part two.
No, it's part three.
Part three.
Totally dies.
Yeah. Because you can't just have a spare baby in this plot and not come back to it.
Right. Yeah, I feel like there's a reason why Uhtred had this baby, and that is going to be a thing that happens. Though, if that were to be the case, it's a little wishy-washy for me. Like, it's a little too convenient that that's the thing.
I'm okay with it.
And, like, I sit here and I wonder, okay, what was the point of Mildreth? Like, what was the point?
To break him up with Breeda.
Yeah, but Isolde could have done that.
I don't know.
Isolde could have done that, too. So, what I'm getting at is this. Maybe the point
Maybe to get make him, because he had all that debt, like, he had to keep sticking around with Alfred. Like, there were so many other things that he had to do for him because he had this property. And
yeah, but I...
Just an attempt to become more Saxon, and that was how he was going to become an Elderman. It was this low-hanging fruit of, like, oh, this is what you want? Okay.
Yeah. All right. I mean, that's fair. I mean, I will accept that. I think there is a terrific theme happening here that, you know, your faith is what is important, mm-hmm. not necessarily what religion it is or how you practice or what you practice, but faith plays a huge role. And it shows that if Alfred is going to be a wise king, he has to consider all various faiths, not just being a Catholic, not just being somebody that follows the rule and the letter of the law that he sends. Like, it has to be, you know, a larger picture. So anything else that you want to say about this episode?
Don't trust Alfred in the kitchen.
I agree. I totally agree. Let me see if I have anything else. I got my notes here. No, I think we're good. I think we're good. Yeah, that's it. Let's close this. Let's close this bad boy out, shall we?
We shall. Our little lass has joined us. She's afraid there's a bug.
And that's why we're closing the show a little bit earlier than we normally do.
So I apologize. Mom life, hashtag.
Oh, hashtag parent life.
Yes, exactly. So we got to go.
We were talking about sleepless nights earlier.
Hey,
so
we got to go take care of a bug. That's what I got to do sometimes. So
hopefully it's not a spider, because I ain't
doing
it.
It's not. It's definitely not a spider. I saw it, but now I don't see it. And that's okay. Why she's nervous.
All right,
and that's
fair
why
enough.
She isn't getting off of me, because we don't know where it went. She knocked it off the window and we saw it on its back. And it was like, you know, on its back kicking around. I was like, don't worry, it can't get you. And now we don't see it anymore. So I guess I flipped over. On that note, thank you all so much for tuning in to this podcast. We are excited to do the finale with you. And we'll keep on trudging. Not trudging, but I think of trudging because of the swamp. We'll keep on moving along.
Oh, no, I forgot something.
What?
Oh, it's a Mary and Blake Media tradition. It's the final countdown.
Oh, you're right.
To the season one
finale.
Yeah.
Oh
my goodness, what was I thinking?
About a bug.
Well, everybody, thank you again so much for taking the time to listening to The Last Kingdom with Mary and Blake. As always, go to maryandblake.com. Check out all the great stuff that we have there, whether it is the MCU Diaries blog or podcast. We just covered up or just finished our job with Loki, so that was amazing. Or Outlander Cast, This Is Us 2, the Potterverse, talking about Harry Potter, or The Handmaid's Diaries, which is a blog series about The Handmaid's Tale, which I'm very proud of as well. And of course, as always, go to jointhenerdclan.com, where you can get a whole bunch of great, fun, awesome stuff. You know, all the great perks as both of our kids join us now.
It's a mom and pop podcast, so I'm telling you.
This is why you have to go to jointhenerdclan.com. make this possible. You want to say hi? Here, say hi to everybody.
Hi, everybody.
We're talking
and
about
this is
Vikings.
The grand closing.
It is the grand closing.
Wait,
you're
hey,
right.
What do you know about Vikings?
They don't like dragons at all. Well, in the first season to have 20 dragon, that's it.
All right, hold on. Sorry, I just, you know, it's...
You need to rock out, man.
You gotta get your Europe on every once in a while.
All right, everybody, my name is Mary.
My name is Blake.
And, what
do you want to say?
My name's Reese.
All right.
And you've been listening to The Last Kingdom with Mary and Blake.
My name's Felicity.
Destiny is all.